This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the worship service for August 30th, 2020. May God bless us as we seek his presence. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, we open our hearts to you today, and we pray for that work of your presence, your Holy Spirit, the light of your countenance. And gracious God, in these days we wrestle with many concerns, and there are many struggles, but we put our trust in you. Help refine us and teach us and lead us upon your way everlasting, your way of righteousness, truth, and grace. Amen. Here I am to worship.
Light of the world, lift them down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see.
We come before you with humility, with awe, with wonder, and also with deep concerns. We pray for the people who have been affected by Hurricane Laura. We pray for the people of Texas and Louisiana and the South. Oh, gracious God, we also pray for those who are going through trial and travail with fires on the West Coast. We ask your tender mercy. Lord, we also pray in these days for people everywhere to humble themselves before you, to seek your face, and to pursue peace. And gracious God, may we pursue your peace, so so that it will have an effect upon our relationships with one another. In these days, gracious God, may we find what unites us, not so much what divides us. And it is your love that calls us into your presence and experience your healing touch. We do pray for the family of Jacob Blake in Kenosha, Wisconsin. We pray for people around this nation as we come together realizing things must get better when it comes to understanding among people and racial reconciliation and healing and justice. We pray for your help in this. Oh, gracious God, we pray, putting our trust ultimately in what you can do in our hearts, but also what you are doing in this world. For we pray in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Holy is the Lord, God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory.
Glory.
sovereign over all people. He's God of this city and all cities.
You're the God of the city, you're the King of his people, you're the Lord of this nation, you are. The light in this darkness, in the hope to the homeless, in the peace to the restless, you are. There is no one like your God. There is no one like your God.
Here we are. Here
choices we hold in our hands. Let go of the things that have kept us from Him. He is the one who has saved us. He is the one who forgave us. He is the one who has come, is coming again. He's a remedy.
Jesus is the remedy. Our passage is from Hebrews chapter 11, verses 20 and 21. We're in a series called Extreme Faith. We're looking at Jacob. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau in regard to their future. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons and worshipped as he leaned on the top of his staff. And then we also take a look at Genesis chapter 32, verses 24 to 31. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he answered. Then the man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome." Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?" Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." The sun rose above him as he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip. May God add his blessing to his word today. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for your word that speaks to us today about what it means to overcome in life and what it means to wrestle with concerns within and with others and even with you, gracious God. But you call us to learn to be refined and strengthened in our faith. We pray that you teach us lessons through this passage that we may apply. Amen. So here in this passage, we're looking at once again at the extreme faith that the people of God have had. And there in Hebrews chapter 11 and 12, we find many examples of faith. And now we're looking at Jacob. We're also looking at Esau and Joseph and Jacob's, you know, he had 12 sons. He was the father of the 12 tribes of Israel. And his name was renamed by this mysterious man who was also God. Interesting. So we're going to look at this today. But when we look at faith, there are three things that help us realize that faith is the factor, the X factor, when it comes to having a vibrant, dynamic relationship with God. First of all, faith is the X factor that helps us overcome struggles. And we will all have struggles. We wrestle with different things in life. Two, faith is the X factor that calls us to engage a dynamic relationship with God. And third, faith is the X factor that leads us to experience blessing through struggles. Now, there are two nations referred to in this passage of Hebrews chapter 11, verse 20. There were the offspring of Esau and the offspring of Jacob, both coming from Isaac. The offspring of Esau would be the Edomites, those south, that they settled south of the land of Israel and Judah. And throughout the history of the people, there were problems many times afterwards between the Edomites and the Israelites. even though they were at one point brothers. So let's look at verse 20. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau in regard to their future. So Esau sold his birthright at one point for a bowl of stew. He was very much a hunter and very much an outdoors kind of person. And Jacob wasn't quite the same. He was, let's say, more of a thoughtful homebody and one who studied and cared. Not that Jacob didn't have strength. Indeed, we find out Jacob has a lot of strength. But Jacob is one who figures out how to overcome. As a matter of fact, when he was born, Jacob was holding onto the heel of Esau at the time of birth. And so there was always this tension between Jacob and Esau, but they were brothers. But here, Isaac gives his blessing, and the blessing upon his death goes to Jacob, not the firstborn, Esau. And even though they are twins, born at the same time, you know, since Esau came out first, he would have been automatically been given the blessing, and yet, with Jacob working with his mother, they were able to trick Isaac. And at the time that Isaac was ready to give his blessing, they put a hairy coat upon Jacob, so that he would feel like Esau. And they put the smell of the field and everything, and Jacob received the blessing. So Jacob, from the beginning, was a little crafty, and he was quite a character. So we'll see this wrestling with Jacob from an early age, even right from his birth, and then with his competition with his brother Esau. But Esau was not always so sharp-witted, but he certainly was strong. But the two would part. Jacob would go off to a land where he would meet Laban and his family and fall in love with Rachel. Esau would go and form to the south a large group of people. But let's focus on Jacob here. So he went off to establish his new life. And as he met Laban, he met all of Laban's daughters and family and everyone, but he fell in love with the daughter of Rachel. Even though Leah was the one that Laban wanted him to marry, indeed it was Rachel that Jacob fell in love with. And he was willing to work, and he worked up to about 20 years, 12 years and then another 8 years. Eventually he was able to marry Rachel. But when he was ready to leave Laban and form his own tribe and form his own life apart from Laban and bring Rachel and all of their children and everybody along with them, at that time, he heard that Esau was coming. And when he heard that Esau was coming his direction, he was worried. As a matter of fact, he made arrangements for some of the grouping there to go ahead and to offer him sheep and flock. And in Jacob's mind, he's wrestling with, is Esau going to come after me? He's worried, he's anxious, he's wrestling with this whole thing. After being years apart, he's anxiously waiting to see what Esau is going to do. And it's in that context that Jacob has this experience of wrestling a man that eventually he describes as being God. So who was this man, God? It's an interesting mystery. Some would say that it was an angel. Some would say that it was the pre-incarnate Son of God, Jesus, to come, who appeared, you know, in different parts of the Old Testament. But who did he wrestle with? That's a good question. But let's take a look at Genesis 32, verses 25 and 24 and following. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. This man came to him. There, Jacob is wrestling with what Esau is going to do. And instead of seeking God, he's trying to figure this out. How is he going to figure this problem of his brother coming to see him? Is his brother going to get revenge? Is his brother going to, what's his brother going to do? He's wrestling with that. He's focusing on that problem without prayer. And so the Lord comes to him. This man comes to him to wrestle him, to shift his attention away from himself to a reality that there's a bigger thing he needs to wrestle with. And all along, in a way, Jacob has not really dealt with God, has not really engaged in a relationship with God. So the Lord shows up and wrestles him. And Jacob returns the favor. And so it's interesting, they wrestled till daybreak. That's a lot of wrestling. And Jacob was no slouch. He certainly had a lot of strength. In verse 25, we read this, when the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled the man. So here in this moment, this man, who later Jacob described as the face of God, touched him in such a way that it did something. Indeed, in that moment, he was touched for humility. He was touched in a way that would he could never forget, that would leave him with a limp the rest of his life, a reminder. And this matter of being humbled and yet engaging with this man would stay with Jacob in his mind. And in some way, it represents Jacob's struggle, his own wrestle with life, within himself, with his family, and with people around him, and ultimately his wrestling with questions and with God. The man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." I'm not sure that this is a matter of Jacob having overcome to the point of winning, but it was a draw. In a way, the Lord allowed him enough strength. I think this is the Lord, and he gives him the benefit of engagement where the Lord doesn't simply dominate him. He goes with him. Now, I remember times I've played tennis with people. There are people who are better than me, and yet they can be very tolerant and play with you so that you can be at roughly the same level for a while. Then again, I've played people that I will tone down my level so that I'm not overwhelming, so it becomes a nice match. I think the Lord was doing the same thing here. He was allowing for a good match, something where Jacob could learn. And that's the way the Lord is with us. He will work with us where we are. He will help us grow where we are. He doesn't want to overwhelm us so much that we can't learn. This is training. This is coaching. The Lord wanted to be his coach, whether Jacob knew it or not. But let me go now. It's daybreak. Jacob, this is fine. We're good now. But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." Jacob realized that this coach, this Lord, this teacher, was someone who had already blessed him, was teaching him so much even in this wrestling. And even as he considered the own wrestling of his heart and his mind, dealing with Esau and his past and all that he had been through, and what was ahead, he needed that blessing. He needed a promise. He needed a reassurance. So the man, the Lord, asked him, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he said. Then the man, the Lord, said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome." Indeed, Israel involves God calling us into engagement, into questions and seeking after and growing and development. God wants to coach and direct us, and He wants to help us develop. And such was the case for Jacob as he learned that he could know the living God. And the point here of the man, the Lord, is that he has struggled with God, and he's also struggled with other people, and even within himself. But with God's help, with God's training, with God's discipline, with God's direction, he would overcome. And that's true for us. God allows us difficulties, challenges, struggles, challenges, all of this to develop us, to refine us, to make us to be his children who can overcome. And overcome we must. So Jacob said this as he was reflecting on this moment that he saw the face of God, was living to tell about it. He said, "Please tell me your name." And the Lord replied, "Why do you ask my name?" But then he blessed him there. He blessed him. Jacob said, "Please tell me your name. Why do you ask my name?" the Lord said. And he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." Seeing God face to face, that's amazing. He didn't know it was God at first, the Lord. He didn't know it was the Son of God, as I believe it would be in this situation. How did he know? But there was something about this encounter. This was not an angelic encounter. This indeed was an encounter with one who was both a man, but also of God. Who else could it be but the very Son of God, the one who trains and coaches and counsels and shepherds us. The same one who had appeared to Abraham, who was in the fiery furnace, the same one who was with God from the beginning, "Let us create mankind in our image." Indeed, here is the one who eventually came in the fullness of time in the name of Jesus, the Savior. So in verse 31, we read this. "The sun rose above him," Jacob, "and he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip." He was limping. He had a reminder of this encounter. And throughout his life, that limp would at times surface to teach him, remind him. You and I have experiences that go with us. Sometimes we could refer to them as battle scars or lessons learned in life. But when we go through hard times, what is formed within is of much greater value than what maybe we see on the surface. The character that's developed, the faith that's developed. Extreme faith is many times developed through struggle, through wrestling with issues, through wrestling even with God. And wrestling with God is not necessarily a bad thing. Matter of fact, it's much better to wrestle with God than to push God aside and say, "You don't exist." But when God shows up and you have questions, ask those questions. Raise your concerns. Lift up your prayer. God calls us into a dynamic relationship. So this pain in the hip was a blessing. And after that event, the very next day, all these things that Jacob was worried about, Jacob came to realize that he had to trust in God. And so when Esau came, they embraced all that struggle, all the conflict of the past. They put it aside. They didn't wrestle with one another. They embraced one another to forgive each other. We need so much healing in our time. We need so much healing between this group or that group. But sometimes we wrestle. Sometimes we resist God and His calling. Peacemaking is not an easy thing, but we must humble ourselves before God. Then, of course, Jacob went through many other things in his life. Eventually, he had 12 sons total, and one of them, Joseph, was his favorite. He gave him a coat of many colors, and Joseph was despised by his brothers. They sold him into slavery. He went to Egypt, dragged over there, put in a place of service, and then put in jail, falsely accused, and then vindicated by God, who worked in different ways where Joseph was given the ability to interpret dreams. And he ended up blessing not only Egypt, but the people of God who came to find help and resources. Eventually, reconciliation took place again between Joseph and his brothers. And eventually, Jacob saw his son Joseph, who he thought was lost, but now is found. And Joseph saw his younger brother Benjamin. Indeed, there was reconciliation all through this season of loss that Jacob went through and struggle. He learned to trust God, overcome the challenges, and it taught his whole family a lesson. The 12 tribes came from Jacob, who wrestled with God. And Joseph was a blessing, later called Ephraim. Indeed, after all these things, and reuniting with Joseph, these 12 tribes were able to resume life back in the Holy Land and grow and flourish. Jacob had a testimony of God's grace. And now we find, going back to Hebrews again in verse 21, a reflection of the life of Jacob and how he blessed, before he died, Joseph and his two sons. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons and worshiped as he leaned on the top of his staff. Yes, even to the end. We see the evidence of that encounter that he had with the Lord. The staff that he needed because the Lord had touched his hip and had placed a reminder, a pain in a way, but also a seed of faith. A reminder that God so loved him that he was patient with him, even when he wrestled with him. Each of us may have different ways that we wrestle with God or wrestle with things in life. But yet God calls us into engagement, a dynamic relationship, to trust Him. Jacob had a testimony of God's grace. May we, in our life, whatever we may be going through, humble ourselves before God, learn from God, let God coach us, teach us, even in those engagements that sometimes seem like wrestling. And as we interact with one another, let's also learn from one another. Let us grow together. Adversity can build character, and we are called into training so that we can be participants in the work of God's kingdom. Extreme faith, three things to conclude. Extreme faith allows us to wait while God's plan unfolds. And by faith, too, we wrestle with God, ourselves and others. And three, by faith, we discover how God blesses us to bless others. And that's what Jacob discovered. He shifted from a self-focused life to a blessing-focused life where God ignited his heart, engaged him so that he could bless others. May the Lord be with us as we seek to put into faith, into action our faith. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for your love for each one of us. And whatever engagement we may be having in our life, whatever challenges, whatever struggles, whatever wrestling that's going on within us and around us, may we seek your peace, your reconciliation, your redemption. Lord, may we be peacemakers. And we pray, gracious God, that we look to your Son, Jesus, and put our trust in him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May God bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen. Have you decided to follow Jesus? He's calling each of us to come and follow him.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. I'm going I